I am a surgeon in America. I am a graduate of Lakhat Medical College, Jamshoro in Sindh. And I've been in America for the last 48 years. First 6 years in training, and I've been a surgical consultant for the last 42 years. I'm 70 years old, I'm close to retirement. I'm a full-time surgeon, trauma surgeon, and I'm head of the trauma team at my hospital in Chicago. So about 6 months ago, the dean of Islamabad Medical Dental College gave a presentation in Chicago, and in his presentation he invited people to come and interact and share their knowledge with students and doctors in Pakistan. I approached Professor Shah, the dean, in the break time. I said, I'm coming, and please arrange, I can give 2 lectures, and that will be an introduction of a relationship, not only of myself, but being the former president of Pakistani doctors in America, 20,000. I could spread the word. I have to see your facility, and I'm most impressed what I saw. Today is a direct result of that conversation. And after I did some soul searching, I discussed with my wife, and whatever I've seen is quite impressive. And I shared some of my experience with the students today, and it's a start, first step. And hopefully not only me, but other doctors from America or the world, if they see this, will be able to come and interact with you. I never, when I was a student, granted many years ago, we never had this kind of an insight. And I was inspired by surgeons, but I was mostly inspired by the outcomes. The inspiration to students, in my opinion, is that if I could do it, so could you. And I'm not, you know, I'm from a modest family. I'm from a farming community. My parents, grandparents have been farmers. And I'm not trained, I'm not a student, as one of the top students of the country, the top colleges being Aga Khan or King Edward Medical College with history of 150 years, Dow Medical College. I'm from the backyard of the backyard, as they say. And if with proper training, with God's help, if I could do it, so could you, so could any student. The sky's the limit. You could only achieve what you could dream of. And I just want the students to dream big. You could achieve it. You know, mohabbat mujhe un jawanon se hai, sitaron pe jo dalte hain kaman. Jo jitni unchi aap kaman phenk sakenge, utna climb kar sakenge. Don't ever give up. Hard work, learn, and I would say, if I could inspire even one student with the example that your environment, your quality of training, your background, and whatever you are missing, I can impart that to you, and to be best prepared to serve humanity in this country or wherever you please to be, if I could make it and achieve what I have achieved, you could too. And if I could impart that level of confidence, that if he could do it, I could so, you know. I would say I have done my job. I have a partner, she's a female surgeon. My daughter is a female surgeon. She's the head of the breast cancer program at a major university. It is my desire for her to come. She'll be visiting in 2 weeks. And if she has the time during this visit, if not, I would say certainly at the next visit, we would want her. You could talk to her directly. She's American born, American educated, American medical school. Those 100 medical schools I talked about, she's from one of them. She had a training in surgery. She has a training in breast cancer. She's head of the breast cancer program at a major university, teaching hospital. And she loves it. So I think there's a lot of, one of my partners, she's a female surgeon. She used to be air hostess before she got excited to become a surgeon. Her husband is a pilot. And our son-in-law, is a surgeon, he's endocrine surgeon. The husband and wife, I call them power couple. I think he's an endocrine surgeon, American born, American educated, fellowship, Faiza, her name, she had a fellowship at UCLA, University of California, Los Angeles. And Shabir, her husband, Our son-in-law had training after Chicago. He went to MD Anderson, one of the top cancer hospitals, and he is endocrine surgeon. I will recommend to them, they come and give a lecture on endocrine surgery, breast surgery, and be a part of the faculty. Well, that opportunities are there. I'll give you an example of somebody who was a final year student last year at Law Medical College. Her name is Sidra Saleem. She's from a very poor family. Her father is a steel mill worker, and the Citizens Foundation established a school in their village, which is on the outskirts of Karachi. Some goat, unincorporated goat area, they call it, and like a dusty, there's no pakka road, and she was given a scholarship by Citizens Foundation. She got admitted to Dow Medical College. She was a senior student. She passed the exams that are done by senior students to go to America. And then there was one exam for which she was 3 months in Chicago. We have a place for people in that category in all the major cities where we house them free. Let's say if you come in and you apply and you get a clerkship, and over there the exam, you can appear in the exam, and you can, what we call like a shadow. You see, I have students where we have a contractual relationship. I teach them surgery, they are with me for, that's called a core rotation, core clerkship. And with medical colleges, I have four students with me at all times. But Sidra Saleem, her example is relevant to your question. She was there. And she approached our association. The association called me, and she was able to shadow me for 4 weeks. And she had interest in not only experience, but to write a paper. I assigned her. I said, why don't you look at, we can pick up like last 100 colon resections for cancer, diverticulitis, or we can look at gallbladder surgery. And so she said, well, let's see if we do a research on, if you give me records. I said, well, okay, we brought up a proposal. I mentioned to her that I will provide her the records of last 2 years consecutive, all gallbladder surgeries we did in 2 years. And you determine what were the symptoms, what were the signs, what were the investigations done, what did we find at surgery, how many people had common duct stones, how many people had pancreatitis, what was the outcome, how many people needed surgery again, and we compare that with the world experience. So she sat down, she was very good, she did the research. We had, I think, 300 plus cases, and she compared comparative analysis. And I think if the world literature said 6% of the people with gallbladder stones have concomitant bile duct stones, our experience is 16% have a common duct stones. Why did they only find 6%? Because they did not do intraoperative cholangiogram on all of them. We did intraoperative cholangiogram on all of them. So the conclusion was that you must do an intraoperative cholangiogram. There are some indications of intraoperative cholangiogram which are must. I did intraoperative cholangiogram on everybody, okay? And I found much higher incidence of bile duct stones. So that means there are quite a few people who are having gallbladder surgery due to stones. And if you don't look for something, you never find it. We looked for it, and our find rate was 3 times as much as the world literature. So there were some decent conclusions, and we wrote a paper. And I will give you a copy of the paper with her name on it. It says me, trauma surgeon, general surgeon, my partner, Dr. Goliath, and Sidra Saleem, senior medical student, Dow Medical College. So if you are there, and we say, let's look at the breast surgery, let's look at appendicitis, let's look at colon cancer. Within 2 weeks, we may have 100, 200 cases. And you write it up, that becomes a feather in your cap. It helps you to get residency. And I think she came to our house a few times. My wife is here, she really, I mean, the kind of communication she did to me her experience, I think she was delighted that all her objectives were met. The government, the municipalities are very autonomous, and the municipalities, like for example, if what like this Banigala is a community, like a DHA, that community, the ambulance service, like maintenance of roads and streets, the street lights, fire department, police department, are all controlled by each community, including the paramedics, the first responders. They are linked up to the fire department. And so these paramedics are, their training under our supervision is funded by the community in which you live, where the hospital is. So those, they provide the funds, and we guide them and tell them to be trained. And the training, you can say there are two major aspects of training. One is the ambulance crew, and the other one is when it comes to the hospital and the nurses. And then the third tier is the emergency room doctor. The final tier is the trauma surgeon. I am told when the trauma alert happens, I get a signal that there is a trauma in our catchment area. Okay, and many times I call back, I want to say I'm available, and so the person comes in. And it's the call of the let's say, do you call it a casualty medical officer, the doctor who's in the emergency room? We over there, we call them emergency rooms. Here you may call them casualties, but once I get alert when the patient is on the field, this is what's going on. And if I want to give them some direction, those people are trained, and the nurses are trained, and we have a dedicated area in the emergency room where the trauma patient will come in. The trauma surgeon is kept informed. Many times you give directions, and until the investigations are done, the diagnosis is suspected and confirmed. And then some people go to surgery, some people get admitted to ICU, some people are fine, they go home. The entire program follows a protocol. The protocol is established by the American College of Surgeons, and everybody has to abide by the protocol. If you don't abide by the protocol, you will lose your trauma center designation. Probably two or three life-saving things you can do. You come in there and you see the person is unconscious. He's not breathing. Okay, you can start a CPR. And you make sure there is something in, he may have choked on a peanut. He was eating a strawberry, or he was eating a cherry, or he was eating a badam or something. Or there is a child, you know, he was playing with something on a button and swallowed a coin. Or the person, you could choke on something. So if there's something, you can use your finger to clear the airway. You can breathe, you can do a CPR. And then you determine if the person has a pulse. If the person is not breathing, then you have to whatever, you can do a CPR. If the person is warm, in an accident or an unconscious situation, was that witnessed event? I mean, the person said, you know what, he was standing here and then he fell down. Or was it somebody, there's nobody there. There's a person not breathing, unconscious, in a remote place. You drive by, you see a person lying, you get out of your car, and you go there, and the event is unwitnessed. Okay, you don't know how long the person has been down. So you see if the person is warm, you get some idea how long this could happen. You do CPR. If there is obvious bleeding, there's one thing. You could put a finger on the bleeding. You could wrap up something. You can take off your coat, or you can take off your dupatta and wrap it up. If there is an outright bleeding, you can see if the person has, the neck veins are engorged and there is a shift of trachea. If you have a needle, you can puncture the pleura, and if there's a tension pneumothorax, some of these things are life-saving, and you could do that. And sometimes if somebody has an injury to the leg and there is a lot of blood but it's not pumping, you think it's a vein, you just simply elevate the leg. A venous bleeding will stop by just elevating the extremity above the level of the heart. So you could do a life-saving maneuver in some situations. I have not visited the hospital yet. I am extremely impressed by Mr. Akbar Niazi and his service in Saudi Arabia and his desire to come back and give back to the country where he came from. He did not forget, and he whatever he had earned, he has. It's, this hospital is in a category of what's called a non-for-profit. That doesn't mean that, and it's not free, it's not charitable, it's not free. There are some hospitals that are free. This hospital does charge nominal amount, cost basis. And whatever surplus money they have dedicated to reinvest in the system. So that effort needs to be appreciated and duplicated in other places. By example, just like the goodness spreads, just like the evil spreads, goodness spreads. Okay, and it's not a goodness unless it spreads. Other people have to say, you know what, this is good, and I'm going to spread it. So, Akbar Niazi, I mean, his dedication to this area and his building a hospital medical school is no small achievement. It's a big achievement. And I see a day that, you know, just like Shifa International, just like Aga Khan, I think this place has the potential to achieve and be an example of, I'm extremely impressed in a few years what you have achieved. You know, institutions take generations and generations to build. And you know, Harvard University established more than 200 years ago. You wouldn't believe the endowment fund they have. And you know who are their biggest contributors? The previous students who have gone to high positions. And though they have left in their will millions of dollars for Harvard or Stanford or Yale or Princeton, University of Chicago. I have a friend, University of Chicago School of Medicine is known as Pittsburgh School of Medicine. These are the people, they own Hyatt hotels nationwide, worldwide. And that family established a medical school almost 75 years ago. They have produced several Nobel Prize winners at the university. Several Nobel, you can look at the list, University of Chicago, several in economics and medicine. And J.B. Pritzker, the grandson, gave $100 million to Northwestern Law School. So, because he's graduate from Northwestern Law School, just imagine. And so as the people who cannot on hands-on deliver, if they find an organization credible, like this is, then people, as they succeed in life, they give back. They can give back in two ways, either personally, physically, or financially. आपके पास दो चीजें हैं ना, ये आपका माल है, you know, आपकी physical being है. So those people who could help physically, a lot of people could help financially. So major institutions, their alumni, their graduates, have left in their will that the part of their estate will go to their heirs, to their family, and part of their estate, their inheritance, they dedicate, let's say 10-15% to the university. So so that happens, and it will happen. It happens with every institution, and I'm sure it will happen here. But the seed has been properly placed by the Niazi family, and particularly the chairman, Mr. Akbar Niazi. This is the first time I've been here. I had heard about it. I'm glad I'm here. And I think what I saw is more than I expected. Dil khush ho gaya. The atmosphere has been created. I mean, we drove in. My wife is with me. We drove in. And the locality is very good. You have the physical beauty of the surroundings. But more than that, there was a spirit of learning here. And young, energetic, the future of this nation, the future of the world, you could just glance at it. And so that was most impressive. And what I take back from this visit, I said, you know, if this is the future, I like it.